Well, it's hard to believe that only a week ago we were talking about the summit between US President Donald Trump and North Korea's Kim Jong-un. This week, Mr. Trump was forced to back down on his hardline treatment of asylum seekers after an extraordinary backlash. But the United Nations says Trump's decision to stop separating families may not be enough. Detaining children is a human rights violation, and the UN says that his policy could amount to torture under international law. Now, since the zero tolerance policy was enacted in April, more than 2,300 children have been detained from their parents. The vast majority of these people have come from Guatemala, El Salvador and Honduras, countries with high rates of violence and poverty. All right, let's bring in our panel now. Marianne, you've got some experience as a human rights lawyer. What was your reaction when this story started to emerge? It's been going on for a while, but this was pretty extreme.
It was, and this is what happens often with these stories. So there have been journalists, I don't know if you follow the story that's been covered by Reveal, who have been trying to get this story out for some time. And often what it will take is one of those iconic images, as we saw this week. It's horrifying. It's extraordinary that anybody would agree to sign this into policy, that, you know, children and even infants were being separated from their families and detained separately from their parents. The back down, I think a lot of people will be very, very pleased at that these children are, in theory at least, going to be reunited, although they don't seem to
be. But it's going to stick them in camps, right? It's going to stick them in army camps.
They're going to put the families together but continue to detain them. Mm. So that continues to be illegal. There is no legal basis for detaining children on the basis that their parents have sought asylum. So this is not a good outcome. It is a very slight improvement. Obviously, having children with their parents is not slight. It's significant, but in terms of the conditions. So we have to keep the pressure on about this. The other thing that does make this sort of ethically and morally so complex is that the US is not alone in this policy. We have our neighbours right next door in Australia pursuing a very similar policy where children are detained indefinitely, generally with their parents. But, you know, sometimes where children have been separated and arrived in Australia separately from their parents, children are being detained indefinitely. So I think this is an opportunity for us to really say, okay, we have to take a stand as a country.
Is this a luxurious position for New Zealand, though? We do not have borders, essentially, with large numbers of migrants or asylum seekers trying to get here. Are we able to make that sort of comment? I mean, we don't have the same problem as Australia and the US, do we?
I look at the potential refugee challenges that New Zealand will face along the lines of a disaster preparedness. I mean, if we think of the Pacific, think of climate change, think of what will happen for the 2.5 million people who live throughout the Pacific in 10 years' time. And we need to start thinking about it, and I agree with Marianne, on taking a real leadership role in the way we prepare for refugees here. Right now, it's not something that affects us because of our geographic isolation. But we need to be thinking about it in terms of our Pacific neighbours, because Australia is certainly the rhetoric from them is they're not going to be doing a lot. But we, I think, have the capacity. And I think we need to start warming up the New Zealand public around that, the fact that we're going to have people coming to New Zealand sometime in the next 15 years in quite a significant way. And that actually, that's OK. There are ways to integrate those people. I think if the government came out tomorrow with a dramatic increase in the refugee quota, that would be problematic.
They are talking about 1,500, aren't they? Doubling it to 1,500. But even some are suggesting that that will be a stretch for New Zealand.
Yeah, I mean, we have been low in terms of the quota of asylum seekers that we've taken for so long that we will be playing catch-up. And while our NGO sector is strong, compared to, say, Canada and the way the government and the NGO sector is funded and resourced to support refugees, we don't look like we're there yet. I would say, though, that the Trump reaction and the way in which he's politicised this issue is that these are not Mexican, these are not immigrants from Mexico, they are from these countries. That's the only increase in numbers that we've seen because they're coming from conflict situations. What we're not seeing is a massive increase in immigrants generally. The numbers aren't nearly as high as what they were under Bush, Clinton and Reagan. So this is a this is political rhetoric rather than an immigration crisis.
But you've just been in Europe and they're about to have a summit there on this issue, and they're not in agreement at all either. Italy and France at each other's throats is a real... That's got the potential to blow as well.
Yes, and I think we also see in Germany the pushback against Angela Merkel's government and her open-door policy. I mean, the issue there with Syria and with what's happening, the way in which Libya is inserting itself to push boats of migrants back, it is... These things are intensified by conflict situations rather than economic migrants. And so that's where the emphasis needs to be. And yes, it's a...
I want to see if I can bring if we can bring up the vision of Melania Trump's jacket. Now, I know that sounds a little trivial, but it caused such confusion because she's in an immigration centre. She had come out and criticised her own husband, and then she wears this jacket which says, I really don't care, do you? Now, it was unclear as to what that meant, but this is an example of the difficulty now with all US politics, that the trolling, the media, the polarisation, it's very hard to get a grasp on anything.
Yeah, I mean, one of the things that concerns me about this is that the conversation must be about those children and their families. And as soon as the conversation becomes about anything else, whether it's Melania's jacket or whether it's about, you know, liberal snowflake, whatever it is, it's like we have to keep bringing the conversation back to something that we can all relate to as humans, that we can feel a sense, a deep, deep, basic sense of wrongness. And obviously this was either an intentional or an extraordinary unintentional distraction from that. I'm going to presume it was an intentional distraction. And that's, you know, that's the depth to which in some ways the political rhetoric is dropping in the US. And I just think for anybody who's interested in this, we've got to keep, the conversation has to stay focused on this.
Because what was interesting about this particular flare-up in the US is that it did cut through on an emotional level. And unlike perhaps tariffs or these sorts of things, he backed down really fast.
Yeah, he did back down fast, and rightly so. But I think, you know, Melania's jacket, I think there will be there's people in New Zealand who'd say, oh, yeah, I don't care about that either because I'm focused on my issues at home. And I think we have to, and our government, they need to be very aware of what the sentiment is around the country about these European trade deal and our relationship with China and with the US, because it's for a lot of people, it's a long way away. And we've got a lot of issues here. And so we've got to have quite a nuanced discussion around that. I think it all relates... The interview with the Trade Commissioner. I mean, the biggest issue in Europe right now is the refugees. And yet, what's our role within that? And we've got people saying, I don't care. Actually, we do care. We all care at a human level, and that's what we need to be projecting and putting that rhetoric out there.
On that interview with the EU Commissioner, I mean, that is one bright spot, isn't it? That there is some shared values with the European Union for New Zealand and a chance for a decent trade deal.
Yeah, so the EU is really strong on that all trade deals that it has incorporate or express the values that the EU holds dear. And I would have to say it's good for New Zealand because apart from the whole actual trade, their value system is that they are more progressive on, or looking to be more progressive on both...
Well, we know investor state tribunals, for example.
Yeah, but also in the area of wanting to see sustainability and wanting to see good social rights and labour rights and the protection of those who are often losers in trade deals. So the delegation that was out earlier this year were really explicit about this, that they've realised now, many economists in Europe, that previous trade deals were really good for business but really tough for workers. And so we're going to see some different kinds of narratives being used in putting this deal together.
Marianne, I wonder whether, do you think that those who perhaps oppose the Trans-Pacific Partnership will be more comfortable with this deal?
I think in some respects they will be, because some of for exactly the reasons that Jennifer just pointed out. There are, of course, a few places where I think the government's going to need to be very, very clear. One is around the biologics, is that how you say
yes,
it?
Yeah. Biologics.
That was a really key issue at the forefront of concerns about the Trans-Pacific Partnership. So that's the effect that the extension of protection could have on the price of medicines in our public health system. And it's really interesting to notice the very different tone that our government has taken on that compared to the Australian government. So we have the Australian Trade Minister effectively saying, we will not budge on this. Australia has a shorter term of protection for that intellectual property.
We don't have that much to give away, though, do we, when it comes to things that we offer the EU? Is that
no, but so that's why I can understand completely why our trade minister's rhetoric is more towards we'll work this out, because he's speaking to his trade negotiating partners. He needs to be aware that he's also speaking to his base. And that was one of the issues that was of significant concern to a lot of New Zealanders. So I think that's always going to be difficult. Is he speaking publicly to his negotiating partners or to his voting base?
Indeed, right.